Hello, everyone. To me, darkness is as clear as daylight. What am I?
You are a nocturnal animal.
I am.
And after 2 years of eternal night, I have become a nocturnal
animal. Oh, please!
So,
you're as blind as a bat!
See, now you're doing Jim Carrey, Ridley.
Exactly.
That's not what we signed up for at all.
Swear to me!
I swear to God!
Swear to me! Where are the vans?
What did you do?
What did you do? That's what he said.
Find the gun! Find the gun!
Yeah, where he's like banging on the glass over and over. Does like every Batman movie have to have a scene where he's like shouting in like a gruff, throaty voice now?
Why did you say that name?
Yes.
I guess that's just something that we have to do. What another thing that's funny is like, I thought it was Christopher Nolan's thing that he really liked to have his actors' dialogue like partially obscured by some kind of mask that made him sound funny. But apparently Matt Reeves does that too. Because some of the Riddler's dialogue was a little hard to make out in the movie.
It's your violence you may find.
Anyway, if everybody can't figure it out, we are talking about The Batman, which just came out, what, like 3 weeks ago or something like that?
Not that long, yeah.
And it is 3 hours long, which is, I'm going to say, probably the longest Batman movie out there. It's actually been, I was just thinking about this today, it's been a decade or more since we've had a solo Batman film, believe it or not. So even though we've seen him in movies, you know, with Ben Affleck, I mean, he was in BVS and Suicide Squad and Justice League, we have not had like a solo adventure for Batman in a very long time, surprisingly.
So. Yeah, 2012, The Dark Knight Rises.
Wow, that's crazy. I can't believe it was that long ago. So yeah, it has been 10 years. So one of the reasons that I wanted to talk about year one was because I had thought upon watching this movie that tonally it was really similar and that it maybe was pulling some elements from that story for Matt Reeves' vision of what the Batman is. After having seen it a second time, I think Batman Begins was more influenced by it. But the main thing that we get is there is opening and ending narration by Bruce in this movie. That sounds very Frank Miller-y. Also, the version of Catwoman, oddly enough, which we just talked about in the episode, she feels pretty close to the Frank Miller, kind of like his vision of what that character is. I think she was even darker skinned in Batman Year One. So having Zoe Kravitz play her, you know, really kind of lines up with that interpretation of the character as well. So other than that, though, I think it goes in a different direction, especially in the climax. And Joe, I don't know where you want to start talking about this movie. Do we want to talk about the score? Do we want to talk about how everything looked? I mean, yeah,
there's a lot to tackle here. Well, I do want to start off and say I looked this up and Matt Reeves said at DC Fandom that Darwin Cook's 2000 comic book Batman Ego and Other Tales inspired him to make The Batman, which was an examination and deconstruction of Bruce Wayne's mental strife. I wanted to get into the mindset of the character, and I wanted to think of the psychology. So that, I guess, is what we should have reviewed if we were going to do something based, like, for the movie. But at the same time, I'm glad that you picked this because, one, I think it's, you know, it being a staple, it's something that, you know, I personally, shame on me for never having read it.
Sure.
But also, you know, to be able to pick out elements of something else rather than going to, you know, what directly inspired it, you know, we're seeing similarities even from a different version. And that's what I was saying during the episode was there's so many like different versions of, it's not really different versions of Batman, but it's like his characteristics can be different depending on what story you're in. Like the Batman was really more about that detective angle. And that was one of the things that I came out of actually loving about the movie. Like when I first saw the trailers, I was like, this is dark. It's gritty. It's like Frank Miller. I don't think I'm going to like it. I probably won't like it. I'll probably hate it. I don't want to even see it. And then I was like, I do a comic book podcast. I should go see the movie, you know, be able to talk about it. So begrudgingly, I was like, okay, fine, let's go see it. So I went to see it and I was like, I actually really like a lot of things about this. Like I was really surprised.
I was very surprised by it as well. I think it may actually be easier for me up front to talk about the things that I didn't like, because I think there are actually less of those. First of all, and this is coming from me as somebody that enjoys visual storytelling, me as somebody that is an artist that just kind of fixates on visual things, the thing that I disliked the most was pretty much 100% of the cinematography in this movie. And I realize it's going to be weird. There's a weird disconnect there, because ultimately I really enjoyed this interpretation of Batman. I really enjoyed the world that Matt Reeves painted, but the entire film, he uses a lens on the camera that blurs the corners of the screen. And there's like a circular area in the center that's fully in focus. And I just keep going, just focus the image for like the whole movie. So I did adjust to it about like an hour in, and it's a 3-hour movie. So, you know, but for me, it's almost like J.J. Abrams lens flare things in the Star Trek reboot films, where it's just like, it's just distracting to me, because it's
visual,
like,
clutter.
Yeah. It makes me go, oh, I'm watching a film, as opposed to, oh, I'm watching a story unfold. And so for me, it breaks my immersion. My guess is that that choice was made because we are exploring the psychology. It's supposed to be kind of unsettling. There's a little bit of the shaky cam stuff in there that we would see around like early 2000s movies, like the Jason Bourne films did that a lot. So yeah, basically just the choices that were made with the camera were not really my favorite. But, again, I'm going to say that with the caveat of like, I really enjoyed the production design. I really enjoyed a lot of things about how various characters looked and you know, things like that. I just felt like I want to be able to see it better.
Yeah.
The other really big example of that, I think, that where it didn't exactly take me out of the movie, but it was like I was just sitting there waiting for it to be over, was the car chase sequence with the Penguin halfway through. They strapped a camera to like the car door of the Penguin's car and the Batmobile. And you're following this weird side view of like the side of the car for almost the whole chase. I could not tell you what happened in that car chase. And I've seen it twice now. Like, I have no idea where they are in relation to each other. When there are a couple times that they cut away to a shot that's pulled out more, where they're like driving through guardrails on the road and stuff like that. And I'm like, oh, that's exciting. I can see what they're doing. But when the camera's really zoomed in and it's sort of like adhered to the side of the car, that to me made me feel more like I was getting into a car accident than watching a car chase in a movie.
Well, and I think that was the point though. Like they wanted it to have that, like something chaotic is happening in the story. So you as the audience member need to be engaged in that by feeling the chaos yourself. And I think that's a very, like, that's another, you love it or you hate it. Like you either like to be a part of the action or you just like to sit there comfortably and watch the action, you know, from a distance.
Yeah. Well, one thing that I can really praise about the visuals in this movie is how much CGI do you think was in this movie?
Oh, geez.
Because, I don't think there was hardly any. And that is a huge strength of it to me. Because there was no moment when I looked at something in the Batman and I was like, oh, that looks fake.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, he also it was more, you know, grounded, kind of like the comic that we read. So there wasn't as much, I don't think there was as much opportunity to do a lot of computer graphics, although there was opportunity for it. But yeah, like you said, there wasn't anything, you know, where it's like going back to the Matrix Reloaded, where you're just like, am I watching a video game? Like, this is so rubbery and goofy. It's not even close to real. Like, there was nothing that stood out. And I've only seen it once. You've seen it twice, but nothing that stood out that was like, ah, that's fake. At least not that I can.
No, remember. I was looking for it. I was like actively looking for it the second time I went in, because I was like, man, they had to have used CGI somewhere. And honestly, the only place where I even think it's possible is where they're showing basically like the jet engine of the Batmobile firing up. And I'm like, okay, maybe that was, but if it is, I can't tell. They could have just backlit the inside of the vehicle and,
you know,
maybe they added like a flame coming out of it in post or something, but yeah.
That was one thing that really got me in the movie, though, talking about things that you didn't like, was that he had this giant rocket with this giant flame on the back of his car, and he still couldn't catch the Penguin. Like,
I know.
Come on. What's that for? It just looks cool. Like, doesn't it actually make your car go faster? I mean, the camera made it really hard to see a lot of what was going on, but I guess there was just so much traffic that he couldn't, you know, do a full on acceleration. But I thought I remembered there was one or two parts where he did like accelerate, like he had a straight shot and it took time to catch up to him. Like, again, why do you have this thing on the back of your car if it isn't going to make it faster?
What's interesting is, while I criticize that scene, and yeah, I think that is just a taste thing. Like, that's just not my taste in action films. I would almost argue that it doesn't matter in this movie, though, because the detective aspect of Batman is 100% the point of this movie, and they absolutely nailed it. So to me, if the action stuff isn't like the most spectacular, or if I can't really follow it as well as in some other movies, it's like, yeah, I'd like to be able to, but ultimately the story in this was engaging enough that didn't really matter to me. So that was actually a big deal, because I think we've seen many, many interpretations of Batman now since the Nolan films, where he's basically a master of kung fu and, you know, all the theatricality and all the stuff that comes with Batman as a character. They very much played that up, but you don't really see him piecing together clues or doing any of that stuff. And so I thought it was really cool that they kind of picked that element of his character and really focused on it. And the Riddler was the right villain to do that with, too, because he's the guy that's going to be leaving clues and all that kind of stuff. So, yeah, it's interesting. It's one of those where I'm like, the visual style of what they did with the camera was not to my taste, but it wasn't so distracting or off-putting to me that it ruined the story, because I think the story was really good. There's actually a really clear character arc for Bruce that honestly I think highlights something that's been missing in most of the modern interpretations of Batman. I don't know if we want to talk about that first, or that, because that really comes into focus more in the climax. Well, actually, before we do that, what did you think of the suit? And I guess throw the Batmobile in there too. Like, what did you think of just how those looked?
What they did to the headpiece was a little weird, with the way his mouth like kind of hung out, like it was it was further back so you could see more of his jaw. I don't know.
And it has like a flat nose too.
Yeah, that looked a little strange, like seeing that. That was the only thing that I was like, I don't think that works for me. But, you know, the suit and the look was cool. It was interesting how when he pulled the suit off, he still had the black makeup. And that's been like for such a long time. Like, you see characters in these types of shows and movies that wear these masks or hoods or whatever, and they've got that dark makeup on. And as soon as they pull their hood or mask off, their face is like clean and their hair is like slick back, like they just combed it. And, you know, they look Hollywood ready. You know, it's like when actors wake up in a scene, it's like they wake up fully with their makeup on and, you know, all this stuff, like they look like they're ready to be filmed all the time. And it was really interesting to see him like with that, you know, almost Joker like makeup on, where it's like running because of the, you know, maybe because of the sweat, and like how he applied it wasn't very, because I think maybe it's on Arrow, they show the black makeup like a little bit, but it's like very kind of neat. Whereas here it was very like messy. Like, you just slapped some on and then threw the suit on. Cause, you know,
But it wouldn't matter is the thing.
Right.
Which is what's so funny about it. That's funny, because I never thought about that until seeing this movie, but I was like, oh yeah, why would it look good underneath? There's absolutely no reason for it to.
Exactly. And you don't want to be sitting there spending time putting on your makeup and getting your suit ready and, you know, polishing your boots and, you know, all that stuff. Like, he's got other priorities, and he's, you know, got a crime to solve. So it's not like he's going to sit around worrying about that stuff. But it was interesting to actually see it.
Yeah.
And not just allude to it.
That kind of highlights something about the movie in general, is that there is a great attention to detail in a lot of those little things that you maybe wouldn't think about normally. That,
look at all them little things.
Yeah, look at all them little things.
Look at all these little things.
It's Gary Oldman said it. Yeah. It's good enough for me.
I did like the detective angle so much. And like, after you had loaned me The Court of Owls, like, I think that was my first foray into like a detective heavy story. There was a lot of stories in the animated series, like Ra's al Ghul actually calling him detective, like as a nickname.
Well done, detective. You are worthy of your reputation.
And him being able to figure out things and be smart, but like really being able to work a case and analyze data and understand what's going on. And like there was a Batman Arkham VR game that came out that was kind of similar to that, where, you know, he's not only being a detective, but he's also using this crazy technology where he's able to do like hollow imaging. And so the bat computer mm-hmm. that's like linked up to his suit can analyze the bullet hole in the window and, you know, on the wall and the chair and blah, blah, blah. And he's able to eventually piece together that, you know, here was the trajectory, here was where the person was shot, and then they fled over here, and then they were drugged that way. And
analyzing Nightwing with the forensic scanner will help me identify the killer.
I really liked the, in that game anyway, using the technology to be able to recreate that. And it's like, this guy's super smart, he's a good detective, and he has this technology that helps him, you know, almost be superhuman in the way that he's able to figure out these things. And they didn't really do that in the movie, but they did have those weird contact lenses.
Oh yeah.
Where he would record everything that he saw, and then he would go back and watch it later, which I think is really good, because, you know, how much can you really remember when things mm-hmm. are going by that quickly? You can miss details so easily. And, you know, even being super observant, he's now got a way to go back and see things that he missed and see, oh, this person was there, or what was that person doing while I was trying to, you know, do something else. And
well, I appreciated too that he was solving the ciphers that the Riddler left. It seemed like he was kind of one step ahead of everybody else with those. Like the first cipher that they got, he solved it before they applied the key to it, like at the very beginning of the movie. And then they used that to, you know, get a different message from the Riddler and all of that, which some of that you have to suspend your disbelief a little bit, because it's like, okay, from that super cryptic clue drive, you decided that you needed to go follow up on the dead mayor's car. Like, okay, I guess you could make that leap somehow, but
yeah.
But he did seem to be, I mean, it was really interesting, because he seemed to be a step ahead of Gordon and maybe Alfred for most of the movie, but the Riddler was just a little bit ahead of him. And I think, I have never thought about this before, but I think that's actually an interesting way to do a modern Riddler and actually make him a threat. Because in the animated series, at least, he was a character that they were never able to really make him work well, I don't think. There aren't as many like memorable Riddler episodes as there are like the Joker or some of the lesser knowns like Mad Hatter. It's like, okay, well, they nailed his shtick or whatever. The Riddler seemed to be one that they weren't really able to make a super compelling story out of. But I think if you give him just like a slight intelligence edge on Batman, where Batman's putting the clues together, but he's just a little bit behind, that makes him a little bit more of a threat. So, yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, he also had Alfred helping him with the ciphers, which...
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
So going into this, I don't like to watch the trailers and get spoilers and all that stuff. Like, I want to know just enough about this movie to know whether or not I want to see it. And
right.
That's it. Like, I don't want to have anything spoiled for me in the movie. So I try to put myself in a bubble, which is really hard to do with social media. But
oh, man,
going into this, I didn't know if Alfred was in it or not. And so I remember thinking, like, I think they mentioned him or something before they actually showed him. But I was like, okay, Alfred is in this. So who in the world are they going to get to play Alfred? Because we have had We've had Michael Caine. We've had Ralph Fiennes voiced him in the Lego Movie. We've had Sean Pertwee, who is the son of, you know, one of the famous Doctor Who actors. Like, we've had all these guys. We had Jeremy Irons.
Yeah, Jeremy Irons in probably like the only movie where he doesn't play a villain.
Yeah. So we've had all these guys play Alfred and a lot of these famous names and like all these big actors. Who in the world are you going to have play Alfred now? And then Andy Serkis walks in and I'm like, okay, all right.
I know. He was so good. He has so little screen time, but they get so much mileage out of it.
But but of course I had to lean over to my wife and go, my precious. When I saw him.
Precious. That's funny because my girlfriend leaned over and she was like, oh, I love him, or, you know, something. She's huge Lord of the Rings fan, which of course so am I. But as soon as he came up on screen, like, she got really excited. So that was,
cool. He's been in Marvel movies. So he was the guy that was smuggling the vibranium out of Wakanda.
Oh, he was Ulysses Claw, wasn't he?
Vibranium. It's not just the metal. What is love? Baby, don't hurt me.
It's funny because I was like, oh, I see. So Batman should have a suit made out of vibranium, right? Because, you know, Alfred's got the hookup. Now, different movie.
Hey, so speaking about the suit, it was like completely armored head to toe, it seemed like, in the movie, because he took an explosion to like the chest, did knock him out, to be fair. He took a shotgun blast to his back at one point. I think he was shot in the head point blank with like a revolver at one point in the movie too. And it all just kind of like, it rattled him, but it, you know, the suit was able to absorb the impact. So that was cool from a storytelling standpoint. And I did enjoy that. However, I think visually it was over-designed. And what I mean by that is basically when we started having stuff in HD, costume designers and set designers started to do all this incredibly intricate stuff, right? Because now you can see it all. But I don't necessarily need him to be in like full tactical armor. As much as that makes sense, and I get it, it allows you to suspend your disbelief a little bit more if he's got bulletproof armor from head to toe. Just the actual look of it didn't quite land with me. And honestly, I think that's just the 90s kid in me that's like, well, Ben Affleck's suit looked like season 4 of the animated series. And so, you know, I mean, it's just, to me, it's not going to get better than that, because just like, that was like my favorite version of his look in the animated series, was when they hit the new season where they kind of styled it after the Superman show and they had him just have the gray and they like dropped the yellow from the front of the uniform and it was just like the black logo a little bit bigger and it was just black and gray. That was kind of like my favorite version of his look. So to see a live action version of that, that was kind of like, that was the bar for me visually. And this was technically fine. I think I'm going to agree that the cowl looks a little bit weird. And I think it's just because the nose is flat. That was the part that was odd to me. Like, why wouldn't they bring it to more of a point or something? And I mean, I guess it's just, you know, that's what Matt Reeves decided on. So the suit itself, to me, a little bit more detail than maybe necessary.
I did like the like arm gadgets that he had, and like he had the utility belt, and I like the tactical gear in the sense of everything that happened to him, especially being what, 2 years out of starting this Batman thing. Like, I would want to wear as much, like I wouldn't show my face like he does. I'd have a full helmet and, you know, everything. Like, obviously you don't want to restrict your movement, but at the same time, like, you're fighting groups of people who are either up on some kind of drug or they just want to kill you, or how many people are going to be like, yeah, I took down the Batman. So you'd want to arm yourself with everything that you could, and, you know, riot control gear. I mean, he should have like a shield, like all kinds of stuff.
It's true. They did. I think this movie was in a really good place with gadgets as far as like, they had plenty of them, but I don't think that he relied on them 100% to carry him through. It wasn't like, well, he's nothing without his gadgets. It was like, oh, this is a situation where I'm not going to be able to get out of it otherwise. I think he used the grappling hook maybe like only 2 or 3 times. it wasn't like a constant, like he's just grappling all over the place. Mm-hmm. He shot it through somebody's leg in the fight scene in the beginning of the movie and like pulled them towards him. Yeah, so there was that. But I don't think he really used batarangs much in this.
He had the one that was like in his chest, which was another Batman emblem redesign. I feel like we've had so many of those in the last like 10 to, well, I guess not 10 years, but the last 20 years.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Like, there have been a lot.
Like each adaptation sort of brings its own version of the bat symbol and it's different mm-hmm. every time, you know, and same thing with like musical score as well. Like everybody's got a different kind of theme that they use for Batman. And so it's like, you're sort of reinventing this character with the different actors right. and the different cinematography and the different stories. And, you know, that was going to be one of my questions too, not to segue us into something else, but
no, you're fine.
But like, you know, how many times do you think we can do this where we start over with Batman and show, you know, either a new angle of him or just a new version of him? Because we've had so many movies alone with Batman mm-hmm. since, well, even before the 80s. I mean, there are some like really old movies from like, what, the 60s or 70s or the 40s. I think there was a TV show. Like,
yeah, there might have been one of those like TV serials or something. Superman had like radio shows, but like early on. I don't know if Batman did or not. I mean, I'm just not as well versed on that. As far as like how many different times can we do this? I think that's really just a function of when did the public stop paying for it?
Never.
Honestly, I mean, that's why if this movie doesn't do well, then maybe, you know, they don't do that for a while or something. But Batman is DC's cash cow. Honestly, he's pretty much the sure bet that they can shoot it up the silver screen and people are going to go see whatever the new interpretation of it is. I would maybe prefer that they play with Superman or some of their other characters more. I think there's more to be said about them because they haven't been reinterpreted so many times. But yeah, I don't know. That being said, that was kind of where I was at going into this too, where I was like, okay, we get another version of Batman. But I came out of it, you know, for the most part, really liking it, aside from those really kind of minor things that I brought up. You would think cinematography would be like a major thing, but the story was honestly so good in this that after I kind of got over that like blurry camera lens thing and just accepted it and was like, okay, well, that's the style of this movie. Then I was able to live in that world and really enjoy what was going on. So one of the things that we always pay attention to though is the score. And I have now listened to it because it's on Spotify and Apple and all the, honestly, all the places you can probably listen to our podcast. So do that first and then listen to the score. But yeah, I generally speaking liked what Michael Giacchino did because I think he somehow managed to push it somewhere in between being fully thematic like Danny Elfman or Shirley Walker and being just power chords, which is like what Hans Zimmer did. It was somewhere like right in the middle of those two stylistically. And somehow that really fit this movie. And I don't know if it makes for as good of like a standalone listen, but it was really interesting where he went with that because he's somebody that we know can write themes. I mean, he's done Spider-Man and Doctor Strange and The Incredibles and you know, scored multiple genres of movies at this point. I mean, Michael Giacchino is very versatile. I mean, he did Star Trek, for crying out loud. But it was interesting that he almost wasn't entirely leaning into what I think are his strengths as a composer. It was very much, this is here to service the movie. And there's a little bit of that Hans Zimmer undercurrent quality to it, but it also has a little bit more of a theme than what Zimmer would do. So, yeah, I don't know. What'd you think of that?
Yeah, so it was interesting because going into this, I did know who the composer was. And so kind of like you said, you know, we've heard him do so many things that I had expectations of what I thought it might sound like. And I was very surprised by what they actually came up with and went with for the score to this movie. And I think it really fits the like emotional and sort of like that noir feeling, I guess, that you sort of get from a lot of the cinematography. Like, I felt tonally that it really fit the movie. I think for me, the one thing that would be like my major gripe is I wanted so bad to hear just a subtle Batman theme or just some allusion to it, because Giacchino's done this before. Like you mentioned Star Trek, like he did such a good job writing his own theme to add to people like James Horner, Jerry Goldsmith. I mean, giants in the composer world. I mean, they've written themes for catchy TV shows back in the like 60s. I mean, these guys were around, you know, like John Williams esque stuff, where it's like these are the guys, you know, the giants of music. And he's taken that music and he's sort of written his own theme to add to it, but then also sort of worked in, like, I think Star Trek's the best example, where he worked in the original series theme at the end of the movie, so we sort of get there in the movie and then we get there in the music as well. And it's so beautiful, I think, how he worked that together. And he actually overlays his new theme with the original series Star Trek theme, and it fits together so well.
Yeah, that's really incredible. Honestly, I still, even when I listen to it now, I'm like, man, like, how much thought did he put into how he was going to accomplish that, you know?
Yeah, like, that was certainly a feat to achieve, and he did it. And he's done, you know, sort of similar with some other works, but I think that's the one that really stands out to me. And so with this, like, I'm listening to the score, and there's like a couple places where he's playing kind of like those power chords, and they start to get like there, something's going to happen. It's like you're increasing in volume, you're increasing in intensity, it's getting louder, and then, you know, something kind of creepy happens because it's following the movie. But there's a couple moments where I'm like, it sounds to me like one of those moments where he's overlaid some new theme with the Batman theme and it's perfect, but the Batman theme isn't there. And so I'm sitting here like, is my audio going out? Am I in mono instead of stereo? Like, what's going on here? And it wasn't there. And I felt so cheated. Because
it's like being on like the edge of a sneeze and then having it die.
Exactly. Like,
you know,
he's the one composer out of all of them that I would say he is the guy for this job, to write something new and to interject just a little theme of Batman in there, just so that you know that's what it is, but not to hit you over the head with it, like with the full theme, like in the 80s movies, but just to give me a little something. And there was nothing. And it made me so frustrated.
It's funny because I work some overnights during the week, and when I worked my overnight last week, I was listening to the score because it's like an hour 56 minutes, which is a pretty good length for me while I'm, you know, doing my work, which is not something I have to like 100% pay attention to. I can kind of have something going in the background anyway. And there are moments towards the very end of the score when Batman kind of has his emotional turn that sound like Shirley Walker, oddly enough. I mean, because when I watched the movie, I was thinking Elfman, like, oh, he's skirting the edge of Elfman. I don't think that's it. I think it's actually that he's skirting the edge of Shirley Walker's Batman theme. And that actually even makes me want it more, because what she did on the animated series was basically take Danny Elfman's music as the starting point and then just go crazy and write themes for every character imaginable. So she really is, I mean, in the, at least in my mind, in the truest sense of the word, she is like the musical mother of Batman, if, you know, Danny Elfman is the father or whatever. So yeah, I don't know. It felt like he was paying homage to some of her work, especially towards the end, because there are a few points where like these soaring strings come in and it gets a little bit lighter, especially towards the end of the movie. But yeah, you're right. It was, it is that thing of like, we know he can do it, so why doesn't he just do it?
Like, if it was anybody else, I'd just be like, ah, they wrote something new, you know, whatever, and move on. But
yeah.
Because of that name in his history, I'm just like, ah, why?
Dude, do your thing, do the thing.
But to segue us, there's something I really wanted to talk about, and it fits with this, is that lighter tone at the end. Mm-hmm. And this actually was something that Batman says that I wrote down, because I was like, this is, I feel like, very either definitive or just very different for the character, that it really caught my attention. And so what he says mm-hmm. is, vengeance won't change
the past. Mine or anyone else's. I have to become more. People need hope.
And I was like, well, first of all, you can't be a symbol for hope, because that's Superman. So that's not your thing.
Right.
Get off, you know, no, but it was just interesting to have him start off fueled by vengeance and why he's doing this, and then realize that vengeance is not going, and fear are not going to solve the problem of Gotham being corrupt. What people need is hope that we can bust these corrupt people. We can put people in place and offices that are not corrupt and won't be corrupted. And, you know, that we can actually clean up our streets and make this a safe place to live. Like, I was just like, this just opened a big door for me of like, wow, Batman can be portrayed as something other than, you know, a guy with a scratchy voice and likes the color black.
Always bet on black.
He can actually be,
yeah,
a symbol of hope, you know, sort of like Superman is.
So what is so cool about that is that I think that shows a deeper understanding of the character than what we have seen in anything really since the 90s cartoon. Because in that cartoon, you can very much see that Bruce is using his, you know, there's kind of goofy Bruce when he's out of the costume. And
appreciate the help, Doc. I'll return the favor next time you're raising funds. Bye-bye.
He's using his philanthropy to help people. And he is the Dark Knight. He is intimidating and scary whenever he's in the outfit.
I am vengeance. I am the Knight. I am Batman.
But you also see him rescuing people. You also see him saving lives. And he's not just pure rage beating down the bad guys all the time. And so, yeah, when we got to that moment in the movie, I was like, wow, they're actually hitting on the idea of like, okay, he started doing this because of his parents. Why does he continue doing it? That's the real question, because mm-hmm. you can say that for maybe the first year or so, but you know, through the course of the movie, some stuff comes out about his father and his mother. And that actually was an interesting layer as well, that they said his mother had some mental illness, because I was like, oh, maybe that explains why Bruce kind of goes into the pit that he does as well. Maybe there's something genetic there that like he is struggling with a little bit of mental illness.
That's why his response
was put on a bat suit. Yeah. And go out and fight crime, because that's not a normal human response to trauma. But at the same time, it kind of forces
him to let go of that vengeance a little bit. And because mm-hmm. in a lot of other portrayals, it's like his parents were the saints of the city, and their mm-hmm. deaths were a tragedy that sent the city into a spiral into corruption. And so he's upholding them as legendary figures because they were what was the last thing that was pure from Gotham to go by the wayside. But in this, it's kind of interesting, because I thought I would hate that element, but I think it really helps him to like let go of that vengeance aspect and be
it was great. Yeah.
You know, like my parents, you know, not that they were corrupt, because you know, he didn't order anyone to be killed. They didn't like,
right.
They just sort of got tangled up on it and it spiraled out of control. So it wasn't right. like direct like that, but still it was something that had touched their family. And it's like, oh, you know, my dad was just a man and, you know, things happen. And it's like, okay, maybe I need to stop idealizing them so much and focusing on that and focus on what the city really needs, which is, you know, hope. And that's why his parents were so favorable, is because they were philanthropists that were doing this work to try to make Gotham better. And there were a lot of opinions right. about that, but you know, that was their goal. So, you know, he can focus on this from an aspect of, rather than I want to make all the criminals crazy with fear because of me, now it's like, hey, I want to give the regular citizens a reason not to be afraid by taking out these criminals.
Well, and what his father was trying to do was to help orphans and disenfranchised people. And then he was killed and all of those funds were basically perverted into something yeah. that became, you know, the organized crime of the city. So that too was another like, like, I think Alfred has the line where he's like, no, that's what your legacy is. It's not like, you know, who your father was or anything. It's like this renewal project and all that stuff that they were trying to do for the city. Like, you can be doing more to improve people's lives than what you're doing as Batman. And I think that was just a really intelligent story point for them to hit upon. And I think it was really good for Alfred to be the one to give him that reality check too, of like, no, your parents weren't perfect. Like, they had problems and all this, but like, they were trying to do the right thing. And that's what the city needs from you, basically. And so that was just such a, like, a revelatory thing about his character. And that, honestly, that makes Bruce Wayne more interesting. I've said it a million times about his comics, is that the version of him where he's just pure rage going out fighting criminals is boring, because the only thing you can do to make him interesting then is see how he plays off of people that are not like that. So then if you bring in the Bat family, it's like, okay, well, now this version of him is okay and it works. But you have that on its own, and it's like, well, he never changes. And so there's no, like, why am I reading Batman? Because he's always going to be exactly the same. So I don't know. The movie just did a really good job of taking him through that journey and ending him up at a point that, A, I didn't expect, and B, I thought was a really good story direction for them to go. So,
yeah. Another thing along with that too is, you know, talking about the choice of who is playing Batman, because I was on the side of, you know, the only thing I had seen Robert Pattinson in was Twilight. And I didn't even see that. I just saw, like, either clips or memes where they're making fun of it. And I was like, okay, wait, you're taking this sparkly pretty boy and you're going to have him play Batman? You got to be kidding me.
It's weird. I find the vampire thing, I find it's funny that people think it's romantic. I never really got it, even though I'm trying to be romantic.
But, you know, he's been in a lot of other things besides that, where he's had to really show some acting chops. So, you know, it wasn't that bad of a decision, you know, up front without seeing the movie. But it was certainly something that I had that sort of stigma, I guess, going into it and seeing
him. Yeah, it was a hurdle.
I was like, for sure. And the same thing happened with Ben Affleck. I was like, really, Ben Affleck? You're going to have him play Batman? And actually, you know, a lot of his, you know, whether you liked him or not, there were some things that he did well, which, you know, was surprising. You know, you look back and it's like, of all the actors that had played Batman, that would be an interesting exercise to, you know, sort of rate their strengths and weaknesses. But I think George Clooney on most people's list would fall sort of towards the bottom.
I always apologize for Batman. Let me just say that I actually thought I destroyed the franchise until they brought it back. You know, somebody else brought it back years later and changed it. But, you know, I thought at the time this was going to be a very good career move. It wasn't.
But Robert Pattinson did something very interesting, and this was partly, you know, the story and the cinematography and everything all together.
Sure.
But something that I took away that was very interesting to me was he was one of the first actors that has actually been where his character is more Batman than he is Bruce Wayne. Like,
yep.
In the animated series from the 90s, Kevin Conroy, you know, fantastic voice work. And he has like a different voice, and it's not scratchy. It's just like a different version of his own voice that he, like, Bruce Wayne's kind of like more lighter and more optimistic. And then Batman's kind of like, he's sort of settled into his lower tones a little bit more, and it sounds, you know, different. And so in scenes when you see Bruce Wayne, he's got this like higher pitched, you know, kind of tone where he's talking and I'm Bruce Wayne. But anytime he's behind the scenes, whether he's Bruce or he's Batman or whatever, he's talking in that like really low kind of stoic voice.
Yeah.
Because he is Batman. Bruce Wayne is the alter ego, is the, you know, caricature he's taken on to hide his true identity, which is Batman. And in this movie with Robert Pattinson, I really felt like he was Batman first, and really he wasn't much of a Bruce. Like, he was still very kind of stoic and
He was basically Batman outside the suit too.
Yeah, he was.
It was,
I expected him to be goth and broody, but he wasn't, thank goodness, because I think that would have been too much. But he was definitely like a little more stoic and hot-headed. But
I think it was it's he almost looked like he had like clinical depression, which makes sense. Because he probably does, if you think about it. Yeah, but it wasn't broody exactly. It was more of just he's sort of emotionally numb.
Yeah.
That was kind of how
that's a good way to put it.
Yeah, like things don't, he doesn't really feel things very intensely or whatever. It's just that there's even a scene with, and maybe this is a good segue to talk about Zoe Kravitz and Selena, but there's a scene between the two of them where she's getting kind of close to his face. And I thought, oh, they're going to kiss or, you know, some kind of romantic thing is going to happen. And he just goes, nope, the contacts look good. Like looking at her eyes or whatever, because he was putting the little recording device in there. And it's like, yeah, he really just does not care about anything except his mission. I mean, right. that came across very clearly.
The job comes first.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, and I thought that was a good contrast from, you know, other stories too, where it's like, especially because you see the lead up in the movie where it's like, okay, these two are going to fall for each other, and they've fallen for each other 100 billion times before. So here we go again. But the way he kind of cuts her off, it is nice because it's sort of like a gotcha moment in the story. Like, oh, you thought something was going to happen.
Yeah.
Here. Well, it's not. Ha ha. You know, that was kind of fun from just watching the movie. But
well, and there's a couple moments where she kind of throws herself at him, but it almost feels more like manipulation than genuine affection, especially because as we find out in the story, her father in the Batman is Carmine Falcone. So she Falcone. I can never remember how to say that correctly. So in a way, they're both kind of using each other. Like he's using her in order to get more information about, you know, what the Riddler's doing and sort of unravel that mystery. And she's kind of using him because he can help her get inside the, you know, crime organization and get revenge for her friend that was murdered by a dirty cop. So they both have an agenda going, and you do feel like there's an attraction between them, but they don't make a big deal out of it, and they don't play it out as some sort of like grand romance in the movie. Yeah, I just thought that was kind of interesting. That was kind of refreshing that they don't. It's like that level of it is there, but they also portray very clearly that, like, yes, their relationship is very complicated.
Yeah.
And I don't know.
A lot more.
What did you think of Zoe Kravitz as Catwoman, by the way?
Well, that's what I was going to say, is there are a lot of sort of big name actors in here that it was interesting to see them in these roles, but then they did a phenomenal job, like Andy Serkis as Alfred, Colin Farrell, who is pretty unrecognizable, I think. Like I totally didn't realize.
Oh my gosh. My girlfriend, after the movie was over, I was like, can we talk about how Colin Farrell completely transformed himself for the Penguin? And she goes, that was Colin Farrell?
Right.
I was like, yeah, look it up.
And then having John Turturro be Carmine Falcone, and then also Selena's father, like he just looks like such a goofy guy to me, but
he did
a good job. And I thought that he, you know, played it up really well. But Selena, like I did like the take because she was so, you know, different than Black Cat, because that's been one of my biggest complaints is, you know, they're not the same character. So don't make Catwoman into Black Cat because it's more convenient, or, you know, that's what we did in the 90s with the animated series. But, you know, and that's what I was saying before about her being more of that like street level person, where she's grown up on the street, she's had to survive, she's lived, you know, with nothing and had to learn all these tough lessons because that's what, you know, life handed her. Whereas Bruce, you know, is doing this more by choice. And so he's throwing himself into these things to learn and to put a stop to it. Whereas Selena, like, this is just part of life for her. And so I think that's a really awesome contrast between the two characters, because it makes for more interesting storytelling and it makes the characters more well-developed. And so that was something I was really, I guess I didn't realize I was missing as much until I saw the movie. And then I read Batman Year One and I was like, okay, yeah, this is the Catwoman that I want to hear more about.
Yeah, I totally agree. What you said about their wealth difference is interesting, because there actually is even a scene where she calls him out. Like, she doesn't know he's Bruce Wayne, but that he makes some comment at some point, and she's like, you must have grown up rich if you think that, you know. And I was like, ooh, like that was a very clear, just like, yeah, we are not looking at this problem from the same perspective. Because he, you know, he's basically arguing the whole like, no, we got to capture the guys and turn them over to the system. And she's coming at it from the point of view of like, no, don't trust anyone. We need to kill the bad guys. And, you know, that, again, I'm comfortable with Selina having a little bit more of an edge than Batman there. So I,
oh yeah,
I think that was consistent with what I think of her character. This might be my favorite on-screen portrayal of that character. I realize that Michelle Pfeiffer is, I mean, honestly, she's Tim Burton's Catwoman. So it, and I mean, that's the best way to describe her. It's just ridiculously over the top. And that totally fits for the 90s movie, but you can't do that in 2022, I don't think. Perfectly fun performance, did a great job. You know, she played off of Michael Keaton well, they had good chemistry, all that stuff. But again, we keep using that word grounded, but Selina Kyle just felt like a real person in this movie. And so I think that went a really long way to kind of justifying her existence in the story too. She had a different perspective than Batman, and you know, that was good for them to play off of each other that way. So
there was something that he said, and I'm trying to remember how he phrased it, because it was another one of those like, so in this, he's the Batman who has the no killing rule, although he,
yep,
you know, totally okay with maiming people quite a bit. And if if they happen to die, it seems like it's, you know, if they happen to get killed, it seems like it's okay, but he just won't directly do it. I don't know, but that's his philosophy. And I think that's a, well, a good philosophy, obviously.
I think this Batman movie has the lowest kill count of Batman.
But yeah, there's definitely a lot less that happens. But
yeah,
in the point of the story where Selina, you know, finds out everything that's going on, she wants to kill Falcone. And there's something that it's another one of those situations where it's like, you have a character, you have two characters, and one of them is like, I'm going to go kill this person. And the other character gives them that cliche of like, oh, you know, don't do that because then you'll have darkness and you'll be just like them and don't do it. And, you know, obviously, like, I don't mean to make light of that kind of situation.
Sure.
But it's become a cliche because it's almost like a scripted scene that you can throw into any movie where it's like,
right,
character A wants to kill them, character B says no. But there was something that Batman said in this movie that I thought was a little unique, and I didn't write it down and it escapes me, but it was a really good
Is it quote. The there's a part where she says he has to pay for what he did, and I think Batman responds with, he does have to pay and he will, but you don't have to pay with him.
Yeah. Or something like that.
And that was more about, you're going to have to let go of this than it was, you're going to have to not kill him.
Right.
Feel like.
And
it works on both levels.
That's why like that, because it was, it seems like, you know, in movies and in general, like we have all these rich characters, but then we have these two dimensional things that happen in the story where it's like, if you two just talked about this, we could avoid this entire movie, you know, a lot of things like that.
Right.
So I thought it was really great that he was like going for the character element rather than just like, no, don't kill him. No, you don't want to do it. No, it'll be
right.
No, don't kill. Like he was actually like, he cared about her as a person.
Right.
And what it would do to her if she did that, like regardless of him, like, yeah, he's scum. So, you know, no big
right.
deal. But
so great. Great version of Catwoman. I wanted to add one more thing that I read online, which apparently, I don't know how true this is because I didn't really like super research it, but there was an article somewhere, and I can't be hard pressed to like reproduce where it was, but something about Zoe Kravitz saying like, I think she auditioned for Catwoman for The Dark Knight Rises, and they were basically like, well, you're not white, and then
wow.
Anne Hathaway got the job, which is really bad on multiple levels. Number one, Batman Year One has basically a black Catwoman, or at least she's darker skin tone than Bruce by quite a bit in that story. Also, Halle Berry had already played Catwoman at that point in a, you know, admittedly not a good movie. But so that's pretty awful. And of course, this came out, but she was talking about in an interview, like, the reason this role means so much to me is because basically I was passed over for it before, and now I finally get to do it. I would argue that things worked out for the best, because I think that this Catwoman is better written than Anne Hathaway's version was in Dark Knight Rises. She has more to do and she has more agency as a character. So I think it worked out, but that's still like a really horrible thing to for her to have gone through, you know.
Well, she did
previously in her career.
She did post something later to sort of recant that a little bit, because I remember.
Oh, did
that,
she?
Because she said that she was told like she was too urban. No, or that they were not going urban with the part or something like that. So she was like, you know, it didn't make sense at the time. And, you know, this was 10 years ago. It was very different. I'm not trying to make anybody seem racist, you know, nothing against anybody or Chris Nolan, you know, it's
too urban though is another way of saying that same thing though, in a way. I feel like I don't know. I mean, yeah, I'm sure that she's not wanting to cast shade on like one of Hollywood's most decorated directors of the modern era, but I don't know, to me that made it more enjoyable to watch her on screen too, just knowing that like she had maybe faced a little bit of adversity trying to get to this point and now has finally, you know, gotten that role that she wanted. So yeah.
Well, switching gears going back to our conversations about armor and, you know, the physical toll it takes on your body. And
oh, sure.
Sort of the, like, you know, he gets caught in explosions and he gets shot in the head. There's a part where he's at the very end where he's just like, what, he gets caught in another explosion or gunfire or something, and he's knocked out and he can't even move.
Oh,
and
yeah.
What is it? Selena's in trouble. And
yeah,
he takes.
And he like shoots up with adrenaline, doesn't he?
Well, that's what I wondered, except it was a vial of very distinctly green liquid. And I was like, is that Bane venom?
Is it venom?
That
didn't occur to me. But he loses his mind as soon as he shoots up with it, too.
Exactly. Because
like they have to pull him back from killing the guy that he starts. Wow, you just blew my mind. I had no idea that that's what they were going for with that.
That's my guess anyway, because like you said, like his reaction is just like, boom, he is up. He is beating the crap out of this guy and he will not stop. I was like, that's more than adrenaline. That's got to be some venom from Bane in there. Like, he went nuts. And it was very green. It wasn't like, it's a little green. It was.
You're 100% right. I mean, I didn't know what adrenaline looked like because I didn't do.
Oh, neither
research.
Do I.
But I would assume it's probably not neon green now that you think of it or now that you mention it. So. Wow, that is awesome if that's the case.
So I don't know if that's like a subtle nod or if that's a, you know, we're going to go this direction in the future. I don't know. But
yeah, I don't know.
It was interesting.
Speaking of, here's an awkward segue. Speaking of villains, I guess we can get the elephant out of the room. I'm not a fan of them addressing the Joker at all in the movie. I'm not a fan of him having a single scene. He has no relevance or bearing on what happens in this story. And he's also been done to death in media. So that's like maybe a 3-minute scene or something where he's kind of like talking to the Riddler and Arkham. Wasn't so much a fan of that. However, the interpretation of the Riddler in this movie is very interesting. And I thought I was going to hate it. But again, it's one of those, they start the character in a certain place. And when they get to him with his mask off and have him kind of give his mission statement as a character, I was like, oh, no, they understand the Riddler. Because the moment he comes unhinged is when Batman no longer recognizes his importance or his intelligence. And that's what makes the Riddler tick. That's all he cares about. It's not even about causing mayhem or whatever he says it is. It's, I want you to know how smart I am. And when Batman is kind of like, everybody's going to forget you, you're pathetic, that's when he like loses his mind in the movie. And I thought, okay, interesting. So they do have that character beat in there for him. Was it weird that they made him into a serial killer? Kinda. But I also kind of think it works for the movie. So I don't know. What did you think about that. I mean, you can throw in thoughts you have about the Joker as well. I just, my only comment was that I was just like, okay, it's the Joker again. Like, I'm just bored with seeing Joker
so
at this point.
I'll address the Riddler part first.
Okay.
My thought is, after seeing Jim Carrey in 1995, and I really like Jim Carrey as an actor, don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
But, you know, that movie in general, just with the goofiness in it, but then seeing his version of the Riddler, you know, at this point, like, as long as he's not in green tights with question marks all over his body, I'm probably going to be okay with the portrayal. The version that they did on the Gotham TV show, he wasn't a serial killer, but he was very much that, like, analytical, kind of cold, calculating mind. And it sort of just, like, led to killing people because it was sort of just like, well, this is what I need to do to get what I want, so I need to do this. And then, you know, it's just part of an equation, kind of. Not that he was, like, you know, a beautiful mind, mathematical genius, but it was just, like, he had that like, analytical mind. So, I would agree with you that it definitely worked for the movie. As far as being true to the comic book character, obviously they took some liberties, but, you know, that's what they do in movies. So, I don't think they took, again, you know, they didn't take as many liberties as they did in 1995, so that's good. But I think that they tweaked the character enough that it fit the story and wasn't, you know, completely outlandish. And like you said, they nailed some very important character cues for that character. So I think that's really, like, the important part, that we hit the major points of what this character is like, and then maybe we sort of alter some details here and there to make it fit the story. Like, having Selina be the daughter of Falcone, like, you know, it fit the story. And did it really change the fundamental, you know, version of the character that we like to see? No. So,
well, and he didn't support her at all. So he had all this wealth, but he didn't do anything about her living in poverty. And in fact, we find out later that, you know, he killed her mother to shut her up, basically. So, I mean,
that was my mistake.
That was my mistake. You are my mistake.
I'm sorry, I overquote that, but I had to throw that
in
there.
We're never going to escape DCUO. the Riddler, all this stuff with the ciphers was really cool, and the clues, and I thought it was really interesting. And again, this was something that I liked, that he thought of himself as, like, cleaning up the city alongside Batman. And so when Batman was like, that's not what's happening here at all, he completely came unglued, because he was like, no, we're doing this together. You know, you showed me the way and all this stuff. And it was almost like he was inspired by the idea of Batman to put on a mask and be like, oh, I can clean up the city. I'm a vigilante, but I'm not, you know, I'm not big and intimidating. So I'll use my mind and my fascination with puzzles to, you know, take apart the corruption of the city. And he is going after legitimately corrupt political figures throughout the whole film.
And
so,
yeah, and he manipulates Batman into helping him.
Yeah, being complicit.
But
yeah,
doesn't really, you know, because he just, well, that's just, like, the way to do it. Like, you know, we're in this together. Like, he doesn't even say, like, well, you know, I made you do this, or I thought you'd be happy or whatever. It's like, well, I thought you'd be happy because, you know, we've been doing this together. Like, you were doing it, you were following the clues, and I was doing this, and we were both falling into place. Like, why are you not, you know, thrilled with
thought
this?
Batman was doing it because he enjoyed it too, not because he was trying to catch the Riddler.
And that just, like, he's so out of touch with reality in that aspect that he, you know, he thinks somebody's going along with something because he's manipulating them. Well, like, no, they're not. And, you know, I think that's really the best part of this movie, is we haven't had a Batman movie, maybe not ever, that's so thought-provoking as far as, you know, what the characters are doing and how they're different and how they all sort of are representations of Gotham, like, different elements of it. You know, it was sort of like Batman Year One, where it wasn't just 100% focused on Batman, and there's some Alfred in there with some witty one-liners. It was like, there's something going on here, and it's going to take all of these people to really figure out either what's going on or to play their part, you know, in sort of restoring the city to what it needs to be. But the thing that really gets me though is in the end, it seems like the Riddler was right, because he got away with his master plan. He wiped out, you know, well, not wiped out, but like he flooded the city. But look at the results. All of the, you know, the corrupt politicians are gone and they need to rebuild the city. And now, well, it'll be a lot easier because, you know.
Except the Penguin is now in control of Falcon.
Well, you know, it's unintended.
Organization.
Side effect, you know, but.
Besides that, they saved the mayor too, didn't they? I think they managed to get her out alive, even though she takes a gunshot to the shoulder.
And that's the thing. She's going to be able to rebuild the city a lot easier because a lot of those corrupt people have been wiped out or assassinated by the Riddler's actions. So
right.
Like, if you just look at the results at the end of the movie, it's like, well, he achieved the results. So, you know, obviously the way he went about it was terrible, but
I mean, it's interesting because thought provoking is the right word, because that makes him a more compelling villain in a way, because you can at least look at his point of view a little bit and see how he arrived at the answer he arrived at. You may not agree with it, but the explanation of like, he was an orphan that grew up and he was counting on, you know, the Wayne Renewal Project to get him out of this situation. And he grew up poor, and the only weapon that he had, you know, Selina had, you know, her survival skills that she used to get through tough times. Well, you know, the Riddler, what he had to rely on was his mind, basically. And that was the only way that he was able to elevate himself out. I do find the scene where he's like talking to his followers on YouTube a little bit weird, where he's just like, you know, this community has just meant so much to me, and thank you guys for 500 followers and all this. So I was like, that's a little bit strange. I don't know. Maybe just because the movie feels so not of a specific time, really, until that moment. It felt almost like timeless until then, but then they're sort of addressing like the internet age and YouTube and stuff like that in that scene. I don't know, it stuck out to me a little bit, especially after all the scenes of him doing that horrible voice and like beating people to death and stuff.
Well, and that was the thing, like with Batman, is like he seemed kind of low tech to me until he pulled out these contact lenses, and I was like, whoa, dude. But then he's watching it on this like square CRT TV, watching the footage. And I think that's like always the way that Gotham has been portrayed, is it's like the almost like this timeless city that is current in technology, but it's like the visual style is just that like old crime drama noir.
Right.
Of, like they drive the older style cars and everything looks like it's old from, you know, long ago, but then they have cell phones or they have, you know, the internet and, you know, they're
right.
Like they stream things, but they stream them on, you know, old looking TVs and, you know, things like that. It's always interesting how Gotham is portrayed that way. And
yeah, it is. It's always kind of a character in the story too, I guess, the city
true.
Itself. But yeah, I don't know why that scene just struck me as like mildly funny. But I mean, it's really not funny. It's like anybody, like, I mean, if like the Unabomber had a YouTube channel now or something like that, I mean, it would be, I'm sure there would be fringe people out there that were subscribing or, you know, something like that. So that it's not completely far-fetched. It's just, I think it was just like the sort of like cordial tone that he had during it that I was like, this is kind of weird.
Because he thinks he's the good guy.
Yeah. Well, there you go. He does. Was there anything else that you wanted to bring up about the movie? I think we've mostly covered what I wanted to. Honestly, all the performances in it were really good. The only other thing that I think I really wanted to mention was, I don't think that Robert Pattinson and Jeffrey Wright have any on-screen chemistry, really. So like the Gordon and Batman dynamic they don't have as much chemistry together as actors as like Gary Oldman and Christian Bale did, I feel like. I don't know if that's just that the story didn't really leave room for that or what it is, but
I guess I could kind of see that, because they're so, but at the same time, like they're so different. And I think a lot of it is like Jim Gordon just seemed a lot more empowered to me in this than he did, you know, even in the Nolan trilogy, but in other works as well.
Like, that.
Like, Gordon's usually just like the old grizzled cop who's like, yeah, we need to clean up this corruption, but he can't really do anything about it, so he relies on Batman. Whereas this Jim Gordon, you know, he's out there, he's investigating, he's pushing back, he's bringing Batman into the crime scene. And, you know, Commissioner Loeb shows up and he's like, what is he doing here? Like, I give you certain liberties, but this is going too far.
Yeah. So, it's funny because I do really enjoy the scene where they're trying to get Batman out of the police station. And Gordon's like, well, you were able to get away because you punched me in the face or something like that. And then Batman punches him in the face and he runs out. He's, because they were basically talking about, like, how am I going to get out of here now without you, like, losing your job, basically.
And then later he's like, you could have pulled your punch. And he's like, I did.
Yeah. Yeah. I think thought provoking, the word that, or the phrase you used earlier, is probably the best word to describe the Batman. It just, there's a lot to chew on there. It was definitely something that merited me going back to see it a second time so that I could piece together some of the details. And honestly, if you like Batman, I think this is a really good interpretation of him. Go out and see it. So,
yeah, there's also action scenes. There's a car chase scene. So there's, you know, it's not all about the detective angle, but
sure,
you know, a lot of it is. And I think that's the important part of the movie. But you still get that action. You know, Batman is very much still that crime fighting vigilante of, you know, you have the multiple people who are coming after him and he's going to have to defend himself and fight all these guys out, you know, to get wherever he's trying to go. So there's still a lot of that in this movie. There's those action sequences as well. So it's not
sure,
you know, a yawner in that respect, but
yeah, it's not just like a crime procedural, like a CSI show, right, but it definitely has that element to it.
I did.
The action stuff, I keep thinking about those two twins that kept getting their noses broken repeatedly at the Iceberg Lounge. Like, the, like, every time you see them, they look a little bit worse.
Yeah, that was funny. Yeah, the only thing that would have, like, really pushed it over the top for me in that way is, like, I was really hoping for sort of, like, a John Wick-style, you know, fight-a-palooza where he's using... you know, martial arts to do all these, like, very intelligent, like, disarm and, you know, just combative, where you have multiple opponents and you're trying to take them all on in various ways, rather than sort of the, like, brawler style that we see. Like, you know,
it was very subdued compared to what we've seen in other movies.
Yeah, I was just hoping for a little more, like, tactical fighting than just, oh, crap, all these guys are punching me, but I've got this armor, so I just need to punch back until they fall over and I'm still standing, and then I'll use my, you know, internal fortitude to escape because I'm so tough on the inside. Like, I was really hoping for a little bit more there, and I felt like it didn't quite deliver in that aspect, but you know, the movie wasn't about the fighting, so it didn't, you know, ruin it. But that was one area where I'd really hoped for some more than we
got. I think it's funny because I think if you're a younger fan and you're looking to see an action movie, you might be disappointed, actually, because that's really not the aspect of Batman they're choosing to focus on. But at the same time, I think that there have been enough movies that choose to focus on that maybe it's okay to make one where that's not, like, you know, the core focus.
Well, so we've had a lot of bat action lately. Like, he fought Superman and he teamed up with the Justice League to fight.
Very true.
You know, so interdimensional demons and.
Yeah. Yeah.
But that's the Batman.
Yes, it is.
That's what we think. But let us know on social media what you think. If you agree, you disagree, you have a separate opinion, tell us on social media, because we would like to know. We really would.
Yeah, thanks everybody for listening to the after show. And, you know, don't forget to like, subscribe on YouTube, and give us a big 5-star review on Spotify or Apple.
All right. Well, thank you everybody for listening. Catch you later.
Swear to me.
Swear to me. Where is she?
Where is she?
We like comics. Because they